I'm Dr. Emmett Goods. I am an assistant professor of music and Africana studies. I'm the director of jazz studies here at the University of Rhode Island. Oh, my passion for music started very young. I'm from a family of musicians. I started out as a drummer at about 7 years old. I started playing the drums, and because I did not own a drum set, I befriended another student in like the fourth grade. And when I got to his house, he had a drum set and a piano and all these other instruments. And one morning after a sleepover, he takes out his father's trombone and starts using it to make all kinds of disgusting sounds and trying to be funny and make another 10-year-old laugh. And he handed it to me, and I actually was able to get a sound. And then his dad actually showed me a little bit of what I should be doing. And he said, "You're pretty good." And I said, "Oh no, I don't know about this." And he called the band director and said, "You know, I think Emmett could be a pretty good trombone player." And magically, I've been playing trombone for way longer than I'd like to admit at this point. Well, I've been fortunate to have spent a lot of my time at URI teaching general education courses. So I get to talk about jazz, I get to talk about American popular music, I get to talk about hip hop, I get to talk about music as a form of social protest to a very broad audience. Music is effective as a vehicle for social protest because it is a common ground. Every group of folks has music that they love, and it's something that we all interact with almost on a daily basis. If you walk around our campus during the school year, you can barely say hello to someone as they're walking by because they have something covering their ears or in their ears because music is helping them move from space to space. So, you know, in a world where people are almost constantly passively listening to music, it's very easy to draw them in to teach them something about music in a more active sense. By bringing it in as a form of classwork or research material that you're studying. So I love trying to bring the non-musician into the musical space and have them consider very artistically music, right? And not using sounds and music theory, but using words and trying to approach it the same way someone would approach a painting or a piece of art. And to have them find truth in it that way, and to kind of do more than just kind of aimlessly nod along, but to really kind of understand the heart of what the person who was performing really meant, right? So that way they can get a much more full experience.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Karen LaPointe, and on behalf of the URI Foundation and Alumni Engagement, I'd like to welcome you to the program today. We are very happy to present the second discussion in our Fall 2023 Faculty Office Hour series. In honor of the College of Arts and Sciences' 75th anniversary, we are taking you on a tour of the fine arts, including art, music, and theater. And today, we welcome Dr. Emmett Goods, Assistant Professor of Music, for our discussion. Acting as moderator of the discussion is Mary Beth Riley McGreen, a digital content strategist in URI's Department of External Relations and Communications. If you have questions for Professor Goods today, please post them in the Q&A section on your screens, and we'll do our best to get to as many questions as we can after the presentation. And a quick note, we are recording the program today. In a few days, you'll receive an email with a link to the recording, and along with some recommended resources for further reading. You'll also be receiving a very brief survey from us, and we do welcome your feedback. Now, I'd like to invite Mary Beth to introduce Professor Goods.
Thank you so much, Karen, and welcome everyone. I am so happy to be here and so glad you could join us. As Karen mentioned, this semester, the Faculty Office Hour series is covering three different aspects of the fine arts, specifically photography, music, and theater. Today we are discussing music, and I'm so pleased to introduce you to Dr. Emmett Goods. Dr. Goods is an assistant professor in the Department of Music. A native of Pittsburgh, he attended the Pittsburgh High School for the Creative and Performing Arts and studied briefly at Berklee College of Music before earning his bachelor's degree in jazz studies from the Hart School of Music. He earned a master's degree also in jazz studies from Georgia State University and a doctor of musical arts in trombone performance from West Virginia University. Dr. Goods has performed and recorded with many well-known artists from the jazz, pop, and Latin genres, including Billy Taylor, Eddie Harris, Aretha Franklin, and Gladys Knight. He has performed with classical orchestras and chamber ensembles, made television appearances, and leads his own jazz groups. Before coming to URI, Dr. Goods was a private instructor, teacher, and band director at several public and charter schools, assistant director of bands and brass instructor at Benedict College, adjunct professor at Goodwin College, and visiting professor at Springfield College. And now I'd like to invite Dr. Goods to join me on screen for today's presentation.
Hello, good afternoon. Glad to be here with you all. And I'm excited to have this opportunity to do this talk with you all and to give you all a bit of a sample of what it is that I do here at the University of Rhode Island. In addition to being a part of the music faculty, I spend a lot of my time working in the general education curriculum, working with students across our campus. And as part of that, I teach a class called Music as a Form of Social Protest. And I've been working with this class in some way, shape, or form since 2016. And so I'm very, very excited to share with you all an area of research that I've done that has grown out of my work here at the University of Rhode Island with my students. And I am excited to present to you all a topic that's very near and dear to my heart and that I would actually like to dedicate to someone who is on our call this afternoon, and that is my mother. So this particular talk I'm going to dedicate to my mother because she is a big part of the impetus behind the talk. Let's see here. There we go. All right. So I will be discussing with you all this afternoon Stevie Wonder, who is for most of us a pop star, an icon in American music, especially American popular music. But I'd like for us to consider him today as a singer and an activist. And I'm going to be doing that from both the musical standpoint and also from the standpoint of Africana studies, because part of what I do here at the university is also I'm a jointly appointed faculty member in Africana studies as well. So this is the icon himself. This is the man who is the kind of the basis of our discussion today. And I love that as I grow older, I discover more and more about Stevie Wonder. This is about what he looked like when I was growing up in the 80s. And this was kind of his iconic way of dressing, but he was sending us a signal even then that he was more than just a pop star. He's wearing an African dashiki here, heavily, heavily, heavily decorated, lovely gold embroidery. He's got his hair in braids, and he's showing us that he's very proud of his Blackness and his African heritage. And these were just small signals that I think we pushed behind the music. And we'll get more into that as we go along. So we want to look at Stevie Wonder from a few different perspectives today. We want to look at both his life and his career and how that affected his work as a singer and an activist. We want to look at the fact that when we analyze his career from a musicological standpoint, unlike a lot of other people who maybe write protest music, which is primarily what we're talking about today, he has one unifying theme. So regardless of what the subject is that he may be talking about as a point of discussion, there's always one unifying theme. He has kind of one solution that he loves to offer to us over and over and over again. And we'll talk about that. We'll be listening to some key tracks, and then we'll have some final thoughts and some questions in our brief time together here today. This is a picture that I love to show my students, and it's a young Stevie Wonder. I think it's important for us to understand that he started out as a child prodigy, a true child prodigy. But this picture here shows him as a very young man in his very early teens, working with someone that I like to refer to as his musical big brother,
and that is Marvin Gaye. And they were both Motown recording artists, and they were both working at Motown and really growing and developing in the music at the same time. And they were going to have a major influence on each other. And in the case of Marvin, he opened a lot of doors for his younger brother, Stevie. And we'll talk about that as we go on. So what am I talking about? What is the significance of Marvin Gaye to a young Stevie Wonder? Marvin Gaye, one of his main legacies at Motown was finally opening up Motown to go from being a apolitical organization to one that was not afraid to let their artists really speak on their ideals. When we think about Motown, we think about this iconic record label who worked all throughout the 1950s and 60s and 70s, but really in the 50s and 60s, they were kind of singularly minded. They were working to get young Black artists into the mainstream pop arena. And in doing that, they had to take a hard line with what they permitted their artists to really be involved in the political space. And they basically came down with a hard line that their artists could not speak on politics, did not readily get involved in anything. And this is including things like the civil rights movement. They did not really overtly come out and say anything. And then magically at the beginning of the 1970s, after a very long time at Motown, Marvin Gaye is able to convince them to allow him to do a concept record called What's Going On. And this was not his first attempt to do that. His first attempt was actually with a Christmas song called I Want to Come Home for Christmas, which was all about the Vietnam War experience from the perspective of a prisoner of war. And this has become a staple of African-American Christmas music that's played in constant rotation. I Want to Come Home at Christmas. But What's Going On was a concept album which focused on, amongst other things, Vietnam, the ecology, what was going on with our environment at that particular time, and so many other issues, civil rights. It was his way of really making a statement about what was going on in America at that time. And this was important because had he not opened that door, we would not be talking about Stevie Wonder as both a singer and an activist. So the early life of Stevie Wonder is rather important to the person that we're talking about today. Stevie Wonder was born in Saginaw, Michigan in 1950, and was really kind of sadly the victim of the lack of technology. And we take technology for granted now. We go into hospitals and we birth most of our children in hospital, and we have technology and medicine and all of these things readily available. And unfortunately, when he was born, they didn't have the technology of being able to have incubators with oxygen. And so with the lack of oxygen he was able to receive, he lost his sight. And so he had to grow up, he grew up having to compensate for that. And with his mother being as protective as she did, she kept him in the house. And he talks about his main company was the radio. And so he just learned how to replicate anything that he heard on the radio. And by the age of 10, he had taught himself how to play the harmonica and piano and drums and anything that would allow him to be involved with music and go to church and be involved with music, or anything that was in that space he was permitted to do. And he just got better and better at it. By the age of 11, he's discovered first by a talent scout, who then takes him to Berry Gordy, the founder of Motown. And eventually they started calling him Stevie, a little wonder, because there was nothing that this young man could do. And also playing off of the success of another African-American blind pop music sensation of the time, Ray Charles, right? Ray Charles was called a genius. And so they called Stevie Wonder a little wonder. And that was kind of the impetus for his name. He doesn't really have a big break right when he gets to Motown, but by the time he's about 12 years old, he records a song called Fingertips Part 1 and Part 2, where he literally does everything. He sings, he plays a harmonica, he plays the bongos. He just does everything on this this particular recording, and it ends up really putting him on the trajectory of being a pop hit. Now, the timing of this is really important. This is the very early part of the 1960s. The civil rights movement is in full swing. And when we look at what his success was going to allow him to do at the time that was really important, it was going to put him in contact with people like Muhammad Ali. So although Motown artists were not themselves allowed to be political or politically engaged, they were constantly around the people who were active in the movement and were part of the change. Here he is with Muhammad Ali. And we know that Muhammad Ali was not only a proponent for change and for civil rights, but he was also a dissenter and pushed back against the Vietnam War and other things. And these are the types of countercultural thinking people that Stevie Wonder was around that would have a major impact on who and what he ends up becoming as both a singer and an activist. It was during his teens, while he was at Motown, that he really begins songwriting. And his ability to write a song is probably unlike any other American popular, you know, musician that we can think of. I mean, his hits before he graduated high school were things like With a Child's Heart and The Miracles, The Tears of a Clown, in addition to Signed, Sealed, Delivered, I'm Yours, which he sang himself, For Once in My Life, which he sang himself, and I Was Made to Love Her, which he sang, for his own usage. And that's just five hits. There were many other songs that did well, but these were the major hits all before he graduated high school. This is quite a resume for any songwriter over a lifetime, more or less than just their teenage years. But the restrictions of Motown were real, and he was feeling them. And it was not until his contract expired at the age of 19 that he really began to see a way to remake himself as an artist. He knew that he would always be Little Stevie Wonder had he just continued at Motown the way it was. And so he steps away from Motown for about a year and a half. He briefly attends University of Southern California and studies music composition and theory, and really just works on discovering himself as an artist. And he's able to negotiate his own contract. His mother had to sign his first contract. He was a young person and could not sign his own contract. And famously, she signed Stevie Wonder, I think, for about $2,500 and a washer and dryer. I have no comparison for that, but that would be like signing LeBron James at 17 for $2 million and, a washer and dryer. It's just not a lot of money. And they made way more from Stevie Wonder than what they paid his mother initially for his contract. But he's able to go back and negotiate for himself. He negotiates a $13 million contract, which was a record-setting contract at Motown during that time. But also, because of the time period in which he's doing this, around 1969, 1970, Marvin Gaye has already done a lot of the negotiating work for him and has negotiated a contract where he is given artistic freedom to produce and to record whatever it is he wanted. And Stevie replicated that contract for himself in his contract and begins to work on his own. And so when we see Stevie Wonder, the adult artist, we begin to really get a glimpse into the mind of Stevie Wonder, both as a singer and an activist. And what we get on his very first adult record, and record called The Music of My Mind, he has a song called Evil. And it is in this song that he begins to present us with some of what he's feeling about the world and about what's going on. And I find this to be a really important. This is his first self-composed piece of protest music. This is Evil by Stevie Wonder.
Thank you. Why have you engulfed so many hearts? Evil. Why have you destroyed so many minds? Leaving room for darkness. Lost dreams can hide evil. Why do you infest our purest thoughts with hatred evil? Why have you stolen so much love? Leaving everyone's emotions lost and wandering free.
All right, so I hate to cut Stevie off, but we are limited on time. But I just want to point out a few things in the lyrics here. He talks about evil, and I love that the title of the track is evil. The title of the album is Music of My Mind. He lets us know that he's having these big thoughts about what is really plaguing the world as he sees it in his 20-something year old mind at that time. And he talks about, he asked evil, why have you engulfed so many hearts? He asked evil, why have you destroyed so many minds? And he says, leaving room for darkness where lost dreams can hide. He goes on to ask evil. He says, why do you infest our purest thoughts with hatred? And he goes on and says, why have you stolen so much love? And leaving everyone's emotions lost and wandering free, leaving people just feeling all kinds of things and being hurt by so many different things. And this was his first through composed, you know, protest song. He goes on to have other compositions on his next album, Talking Book, things like Big Brother, where he talks about the politicians and our political system on that particular album. And then by 1973, he's really beginning to let loose and explain to us who he is as an artist with Inner Visions. And so many different tracks on this particular record, but there's Jesus, Children of America. There's All in Love is Fair. But most importantly, I want to point out four songs that come towards the end of the record. Too High, which is his talking about drugs and the way drugs are beginning to affect America in the 1970s. He has Living for the City, where he talks about systematic oppression. And this is almost like a small opera, if you will, when you think about all the different skits and bits of acting that he puts in the middle of this particular song. He's Mr. Know-It-All, where he's talking about politicians and once again, and what they promise us and what they do and what they say. And of course, Higher Ground, where he talks about how we should be reaching for a higher ground, a higher purpose, a higher calling. All of these are amongst the things that he is trying to inform us about as an audience. And then sadly, in 1973, it all comes to a very abrupt halt as Stevie Wonder is in a car accident that nearly takes his life. His mother writes about it in her book, and Stevie Wonder very often still to this day from stage thanks the doctors and nurses who helped to save his life in California in the 1970s. He knows he's really lucky to be here, an accident that literally almost took him out. And he comes out of that accident, and we get Stevie Wonder with this fresh and renewed sense of urgency towards protest and towards really letting us know who and what he's all about. And who he's most upset with in 1974 is President Nixon. And in the light of the Watergate scandal and all the other things that had been going on, he's feeling even more disappointed. I mean, this is probably his third or fourth protest song specifically about American politicians at this particular point in time. And he comes out and basically names President Nixon in this one, telling them that you haven't done anything despite what you promised us. And so we'll just listen to just a little bit of "You Haven't Done Nothing." Okay, so just in one quick verse, Stevie Wonder really basically tells us what he's thinking. He says, "We are amazed but not amused by all the things that you say that you'll do, though much concerned but not involved with decisions that were made by you." He says, "But we are sick and tired of hearing your song, telling how you are going to change right from wrong. Because if you really want to hear our views, you haven't done anything." He's like, we keep hearing the same song from politician after politician. You're going to change things. You're going to make things better. And he's like, we haven't seen anything. If you think about a young man in his early 20s, about 24 years old when this comes out, is about the age of Stevie Wonder at that point in time. This is a young man that basically saw all of the civil rights movement. I mean, from the death of Emmett Till through the assassination of Martin Luther King. And it is really the failed promises of the civil rights movement that basically died with Martin Luther King when he left us, still trying to work to exact justice for all Americans, that he's really talking about. Because that generation had put their hope in politicians to change things, to make the laws work for all Americans, and yet it hadn't. And so he here is basically telling us how he feels about just that. The album I want to lay into to get into next is probably the most important song in my discussion with you all today. It is an album called Songs in the Key of Life. It's probably Stevie Wonder's most iconic record, and it is probably his most iconic record. And it is from there that we're able to really make one of my points. Stevie Wonder has one unifying theme. If we go all the way back to the beginning of our talk today and really his career as an adult artist, his unifying theme is love. Stevie Wonder offers love as the solution to all of the things that he sees as problems in the world, things that go from politics to systematic inequality, to racial inequality and racial injustice, to violence and war. Anything that you can think of, Stevie Wonder offers love as the answer. And it is really in a couple of different songs, but particularly in this one, which has been used quite often in American moments of American tragedy, we reach for this particular song that we begin to hear how he feels about love. This is very different than how most pop artists would present love at any given time. Most pop artists present love as this romantic notion, this feeling. And Stevie Wonder dives into love from a more biblical understanding. He talks about love of all mankind. He goes beyond Eros and talks about agape and phileo, these larger concepts of love. And he presents them to us over and over again. And this is one of his most long-form presentations. This one is Love's in Need of Love Today. We'll listen to a little bit of this.
Good morning or evening, friends. Here's your friendly announcer. I have serious news to pass on to everybody. What I'm about to say could mean the world's disaster, could change your joy and laughter to tears and pain. It's that love and need of love today. Don't delay, send yours in right away.
All right. I hate to stop this song right there, but I think he's told us quite a bit, even in just this first little bit. I always have to explain to my students that the first verse is him acting as kind of like a newscaster or something like that. It's a concept that many of them are not familiar with. But he's trying to bring the news, and the news of the day is that that the world is at the brink of disaster. And he's telling us that if the world doesn't actually get a solution to this problem, we could go from being happy to all being in pain as a group. And he tells us that the problem is that love itself is in need of love today. And that is a very heady concept. I don't know many other musicians that would have been able to make that comparison, that love itself is in need of love today. He encourages us to send ours in right away. And he tells us that hate is going around and it's breaking so many hearts. He tells us to stop it before it even starts. And it's this larger concept of love that I find to be important. Sadly, a few years ago, now almost 12 years ago, I think it is next month, we had the shooting in Sandy Hook Elementary School in Newtown, Connecticut. And at the funeral for one of those young people who we lost so unfortunately and tragically on that day, Anna Grace Green, who was a lovely young girl who passed away in that tragic event, at her funeral, her pastor preached a eulogy in which he told us that love wins. And he closed with this song. And this is just one of many examples of the times in recent history where tragedy has struck. And we've reached for the words of Stevie Wonder, our sage and our protest artist, singer, and activist. And this is just some of the work that he's done. Stevie Wonder in 1980 probably makes his biggest mark as a singer and activist with a song called Happy Birthday, which was a big part of the impetus to the movement to make Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday a holiday. And also had another really important protest on that song, on that album, called Cash in Your Face, talking about housing discrimination in America. And Frontline, where he talks about Vietnam veterans, and just on and on and on. It's Wrong, where he talks about apartheid. Dark and Lovely, where he talks about apartheid and African genocide. For the Jungle Fever soundtrack, all of his songs dealt with the theme of love. And so he's just had so many triumphs as both a singer, but primarily as an activist with his music over the course of his career. I thank you all for this time today. And I think I'll stop here and pause for questions about any and all of this.
Thank you. I had a little trouble getting the video back up. First, just a comment. Wow. I mean, this was just such an amazing presentation, Dr. Goods. So thank you. You know, first question, you dedicated this presentation to your mom. Did she have a hand in your musical education?
Well, I mean, in this particular case, I mean, Stevie Wonder was the soundtrack to my life. I can remember being literally put to sleep by his records as a child, particularly some of the ones that I talked about, Music of My Mind, and of course, Songs in the Key of Life, Hotter Than July. I know those records in and out because my mother played them ad nauseum. But it wasn't until I really started my work with music as a form of social protest that I began to really dive in to what he was saying. I knew some of what he was saying, but it was just music. And I think that is the point of the course, Music as a Form of Social Protest. Take some of what we know, take some of some things that come out of popular culture and begin to look at what are these artists really saying? These people have big ideas and they're out here trying to solve the world's problems. But sometimes we don't listen to the lyrics deeply enough to even begin to consider or understand what they're saying to us. And I think that was the importance when I discovered songs like Cash in Your Face, which, you know, my mom lets Stevie Wonder records play from beginning to end. So we don't stop the records. So I had heard the song, most people hadn't. And so I didn't really know the impetus behind it. I think we all knew the impetus behind Happy Birthday. I'm lucky enough to be of a generation that saw that change happen and knew the importance of that song. But, you know, songs like Evil or You Haven't Done Nothing or Living for the City or any of these, when you think about what he's trying to say, as an artist, he's using his platform in a way to really change the lives of all people. I just think there's no more beautiful thing than that. And I think that's what we all are out to achieve as artists.
I agree. And I listened to him from the time I remember being introduced to music, but it was in a very different context. It was, you know, over the radio, one pop song, Stevie Wonder, another pop song. So there wasn't that. I never had that education of that continuum or looking at an artist's whole oeuvre to see these kinds of concepts being played out. In his case, certainly wasn't thinking about a unifying theme of love like you talked about. I recognize that many of his songs made me happy and they seemed joyful, but I did not see that. So thank you so much. We have a couple of audience questions, but I just wanted to ask you before we move to those, what was the impetus? When did you have the thought to do a course, you know, music as a form of social protest? And how did you go about kind of curating who would make an appearance in that course?
Started teaching American popular music during my graduate study time. And it was during that I would always try to include music that had a purpose of, you know, a greater good, that was really trying to do, you know, something of significance. And so that's where it started. When I was a visiting professor, I got the first opportunity to teach music as a form of social protest. And I was, you know, very fortunate enough that when I came to URI, that was one of the things that they asked me to bring with me. Could you bring this course to our institution? And I kind of knew I was in love with URI at that moment. If they're going to let me talk to their students about these types of ideas, I was all in. So,
yeah, I remember hearing about it and just thinking, where do I sign up for that? this is one of the questions in the chat. Could you talk a little bit about Stevie Wonder's musical style and how that impacted the messages he was delivering through that music?
I really think his style is eclectic. And I think some of that comes from his own musical training and background. He has all of the chops of any of the great gospel musicians, African-American gospel musicians. Yet he had the great fortune of kind of growing up at Motown and being around musicians who were heavily trained in jazz, and really kind of opened up his mind and his palate to the possibilities of jazz and improvisation. And he had that gift that his mother gave him of being able to just pick things up on the radio. So we see in the 1970s where, you know, he starts this relationship with Bob Marley, and you know, we have songs like Master Blast and Jammin', which are, you know, really good takes on American takes on reggae music. So his style is very eclectic. I mean, we can hear him even doing hip hop now in his own music, whether it's incorporating MCs onto his tracks or him actually playing on tracks for other MCs. There's no kind of limit to his style. I mean, he's taken his music and added strings and orchestral settings, and it just works over any and every possible thing that you can think of.
Mm-hmm. Do you see Stevie Wonder influencing any particular hip hop artists today? It is the 50th anniversary of hip hop this year, so I definitely wanted to get your take on the genre, what it's done, what its potential is moving forward.
Well, I mean, I see Stevie Wonder having collaborations with hip hop artists like Busta Rhymes and Common and many other people like that. So I think those in that generation of their 40s and 50s probably have the deepest love and affection for Stevie Wonder and are really kind of in tune with what it is that he's saying and have found that point of commonality in their artistry. So I think that's a place for him with hip hop. I think hip hop in its 50th is really just beginning to command America's respect as a genre, because when we think about it with any youth music, I mean, rock is basically a term that we use in American popular music to mean youth. And hip hop is just one of many forms of rock music that we've seen over the years. And much like all the forms before it and those after it, we never think that they're going to last. And yet now we see hip hop that is 50 years old, has more subgenres than you can count, and basically has a legacy all of its own and can stand on that legacy. I just think, you know, we're just at the beginning of hip hop really beginning to establish itself as an important part of what it means to be American. Right? This is truly an American art form. This is people who have come from and have roots all over the world and have brought those with them and have found their way to express themselves using something that is unique to them. Mm-hmm. So.
Do you see students responding on various levels to when they're coming into class and maybe they have, you know, they've some of these artists they're familiar with, some of the older artists because of their parents' musical preferences, and they come in and you start connecting the dots for them over the course of an artist's career like Stevie Wonder, or maybe several contemporaneous artists who are working in the same or working on the same ideas. How do they respond to this?
I mean, many of them are really excited when you can connect the students to Stevie Wonder or Bob Dylan or Pete Seeger or, you know, I mean, any artist who has really committed themselves to being about change with their art. Sting, we usually talk about Sting about the same time we talk about Stevie Wonder and, you know, how he was really, protesting against the Cold War in the 1980s, you know, while he's having all these mega hits. There's all these songs on his records that are really pushing back against the Cold War and speaking very directly to President Reagan and President Gorbachev. And, you know, that's kind of a shock to them. And I think that they love it. But the way I also designed the course is the last few weeks, the students get to do presentations and they teach me. They bring things in out of their own library and their own understanding that are dealing with different subjects that they're very passionate about. And I think I love understanding what really the students of today are passionate about, what motivates them, what really has them concerned, what problems that they're trying to, in this time, this 4 years that we get them in college, the problems that they're trying to figure out, what is there going to be their part in making it better? And I think that's the power of a course like this.
And thinking about Stevie Wonder's song Evil, I was thinking about how malleable it is, how appropriate it is to many situations going on in the world today, how he taps into emotions that are primary and primal, and that those lyrics address, you know, kind of ticking off in my head the various global problems that we have, both, you know, in terms of, you know, conflict and war, but also relationship with nature. I mean, it just, the song seems to have such resonance and power and a timelessness that I think will continue. It's not something that's just going to be looked at from this moment retroactively, but it will have resonance 50, 100 years from now.
The music is timeless, but one of the things that I think is amazing is Stevie Wonder is so aware of the times. Right. So, you know, my daughter and my wife are avid TikTokers, right? They constantly strolling through, laughing at things, learning things. You know, daddy does not have time for TikTok, but they send me these things and I end up watching them inevitably. And so I do have a presence out there. I don't put any content, but I watch and see what other folks are doing. It's entertaining. Lo and behold, a few days ago, who follows me on TikTok but Stevie Wonder, which literally blew my mind. I was like, does Stevie know that I'm getting ready to talk about him? Like, what is this? And I go out there, he has a brand new verified profile, and there's only a handful of clips out there. And one of them's literally him talking about us reaching for our higher ground, which is the name of one of his songs, which he briefly plays a little bit of and sings a little bit of, self-accompanied on his guitar. And he talks about the situation going on in Israel right now. He's always trying to teach us. He's always trying to use his music to push the narrative forward. He's not on either side. He's just against war. He doesn't like the concept of people, you know, dying by violence. And he makes that very clear. But I just find that to be amazing for a man that's, what, 73 years old at this point and could be doing anything. He's still taking his music and trying to push things forward. So I think it's interesting that you bring that up.
Wow, I just got goosebumps. And I have to, it's a nice segue. There was a word I just learned. It's French, and I'm going to butcher it because I don't speak French, but it's frisson. And it is the psychophysiological reward of art, especially often used in relation to music. Do you remember the first song that kind of did that for you, that gave you kind of goosebumps, or you felt like either the artist was speaking to you or you were connecting with that music in a way that seemed new or somehow deeper than maybe you had been responding to it prior? Or too many songs to count, maybe, I don't know.
No, I think with me, though, it wasn't anything that came out of the pop space. My mother's father was a jazz musician, so my mom grew up really heavily influenced by jazz. And so a lot of the music that I was taken to see live as a kid was jazz music, which as a kid, watching people playing instruments and no one singing the melody and there's all this improvisation going on, it just doesn't make sense. And I had an uncle who I would often spend time with at his job. He owned a produce store, and he and his best friend would sit there and they would listen to jazz, and it just never made sense until it did. And I remember only being in like elementary school. I had maybe started playing music a little bit. Maybe I was playing drums at the time, and all of a sudden what they were listening to made sense. And I remember feeling like I had a secret, like I was this kid that could hear and understand jazz, and I didn't have great vocabulary, but other adults could just sense that I was actually listening, and they would ask me different things and they would tell me different things about what I was hearing. And I think that's the first time I had this feeling about, oh my God, this music, this does something to you. It lifts your spirit. It makes you feel better. You know,
love that. Lifts your spirit, makes you feel better. So there's a question here from Michael Greenfield, and he said he loves the presentation. It's an off-topic question that is motivated by music I pursue that is separate from my URI role in engineering. Can you offer suggestions of strategies to maintain performance opportunities and audiences for jazz big bands?
Well, I mean, we're definitely doing it here. I think having big bands as part of the academic space, We get the opportunity to, one, train young musicians in playing in a big band, but we also get to present concerts that really get to teach people about artists and about particular issues in particular. I think that's one of the things I love about being a director of jazz studies, is kind of curating these big band concerts. We did one last month on Thad Jones, who is celebrating a centennial this year. We're doing one next month on Wayne Shorter, who recently passed away and was someone I got a chance to meet and really be influenced by their work. So I think that's a big thing there. And also, I love the fact that at URI, all of the musical ensembles are open to anyone. You could be a community member and you can join. You could be a faculty member and you can join. You could be a student and you can join. You don't have to be a music major only. We're not one of those types of exclusive music schools. Those opportunities are open and available to anyone.
Also, this is, I phrased it as a question, but it's actually a comment from, and forgive me, Jill, if I mispronounce your last name, Jill Rasmussen, who says, outstanding presentation. And I concur. This has been a fantastic mini course in Stevie the Little Wonder that I didn't know that either. I was just like, oh my gosh, of course he was. So thank you, Dr. Goods. Thank you to all who have joined today. Oh, Joanna Ravello just weighed in. Thank you, Dr. Goods. Can you please stop telling people about my TikTok addition? Oops, I was not supposed to show that during the presentation. Apologies, Joanna.
that's the other doctor, the Dr. Mrs. Goods.
I'm in trouble. Okay. So as mentioned, within the next few days, you will receive an email with a link to today's recording, along with a few of our recommendations for further reading and listening. We hope you'll join us again on December 13th for the final stop on our fall semester tour of the arts, when we visit with Rachel Walsh, assistant professor of theater. Thank you again, audience members. Thank you again, Dr. Goods. Thank you again for the special guest appearance by Joanna. And have a great rest of your day.